Have you ever wondered why your eyes are the color that they are? In this episode of OcuTalk, Dr. Amanda Salter will be discussing what determines eye color, how unique each individual's eyes are, and some conditions that can cause changes in the color. Dr. Salter?
I want to talk to you.
Not now, later.
No, now.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for a brand new episode of OcuTalk. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for a brand new episode of OcuTalk. My name's Nick, and today we have a very special guest, a returning guest to OcuTalk, Dr. Amanda Salter. Dr. Salter, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me. Happy to be back.
Well, thank you again for joining us, Dr. Salter. It's great to have you back here. Before we get started, would you mind letting us know a little bit about your background and your specialty for our viewers who weren't able to see your last video?
Absolutely. So I am a comprehensive ophthalmologist. I work in Berkeley, Michigan. So I see a range of eye diseases and ages. I would say I have a special interest in dry eye and cataract surgery.
Well, thank you again for joining us, Dr. Salter. It's great to have you back on here. Dr. Salter, for our discussion today, we were hoping that maybe you can talk to us a little bit about eye color. What determines a person's eye color?
So this is a really fun and interesting topic, I think. So what determines your eye color is the part of your eye called the iris. So there are two layers to the iris. There's the back layer, which is called the pigment epithelium. And in most people, that's going to have some degree of pigment. And that's brown pigment called melanin. And then the front layer is called the stroma. And that's the layer where the amount of pigment or lack of pigment is going to determine your eye color. So if you have some degree of the pigment, the melanin brown pigment, your eyes will appear brown to some degree. And if you have a dark brown pigment there, it could even appear black. And if you have less pigment and it's more light brown, then you're going to have green or hazel eyes. And if you have no pigment in the stroma, then your eyes will appear blue. So I think the interesting thing here is that you know, the only pigment there is brown. So there's no blue pigment or green pigment. So how do your eyes end up blue or green? So this is from an optical effect called light scattering. And so it's the same reason that the sky is blue. So basically the iris tissue absorbs sunlight and then reflects light off. And so in blue eyes with no pigment, you're getting the reflecting of the blue light. And in green eyes, it's a combination of the light scattering and the pigment that's there.
Well, thank you for that information, Dr. Salter. We appreciate that. So what would be the most common eye color and what would be the most rarest eye color?
Sure. So you know what I wanted to mention also, which I think is an interesting fact, is that every person's eye color is unique to them. So, you know what, you might share the similar color with someone in your family, but the amount of pigment and the way that it's distributed is unique to each person. So just an interesting fact there. But so the most common eye color by far is brown. So up until 10,000 years ago, everyone had brown eyes. And now about half of the population has brown eyes. And the rarest is green eyes, which is about 2% of the world's population.
Well, thank you for that information, Dr. Salter. We appreciate that. Another question I wanted to ask is it possible for someone to have two different colored eyes?
Yes, this is called heterochromia. So some people may be born with that, or some people may develop an eye condition that leads to that over time. And actually, the one interesting person that I think we all are aware of that you think of as having heterochromia is David Bowie. So, you know, we all kind of know he's a famous person with different colored eyes, but actually he doesn't have heterochromia so much as anisocoria, which is a difference in pupil size. And that can kind of give the effect of different colored eyes, even though it's actually the pupil size.
Well, excellent, Dr. Salter. I did not know that. Thank you for that information. Dr. Salter, I wanted to also ask you, does somebody's eye color change over time?
It can. So, you know, let's first think about babies. So most babies are born with bluish eyes, and that's because they haven't fully developed the pigment in the iris. And so usually over the course of the first year, or in some cases, the first few years, they may develop pigment and the eyes may change to brown or, you know, any other color in between. And there are certain eye conditions that can change your eye color over time. And then there are the rare individuals where their eye color may just naturally change a bit over time as well.
Fantastic, Dr. Salter. Thank you so much for that information. Dr. Salter, can you actually name some of the conditions that actually affect your eye color over time?
Yes. So there are a number of them, so we'll touch on a few. So one would be you can develop freckles or like larger areas called nevus or nevi on your iris. It's just basically kind of like having a freckle on the skin. So that's one thing. There's a condition called uveitis or iritis, and that is inflammation in the eye, and that can affect the eye color, particularly if you have that from a herpes eye infection. And then there's also a condition called Fuchs heterochromic iridocyclitis. That's another kind of inflammatory condition that can change your eye color. And then, you know, there are a couple of things that people think of as changing their eye color, but it's not a true change in eye color. And I think one of the most common things I hear from my patients is as they get older, most people will develop arcus, which is a rim around the cornea of like a white or even like a bluish gray. And so I think a lot of people think that that's changing their eye color, but it's not actually affecting the iris, but it can kind of give a sense of the change of eye color. And cataracts are another thing that's, again, not changing your iris, but if you have a whitish cataract, people will see that and you might think of that as changing your eye color as well.
Excellent information, Dr. Salter. Dr. Salter, one question I had for you, and I'm not sure if you get this question a lot, but are there certain eye colors that are more prone to having eye problems?
That is true. So people with dark brown eyes are almost twice as likely to develop cataracts. But on the flip side, people with brown eyes, it's thought that the melanin has some protective effect against the harmful UV rays from the sun, so they're less prone to having eye cancers. And also brown eyes are at less of a risk of having macular degeneration or diabetic retinopathy.
Fantastic information, Dr. Salter. I did not know that, but now I do. Thank you very much. And Dr. Salter, I know that with contacts, we're able to change our eye colors, no problem. But I wanted to ask, medically, is there a medical procedure that we can do to help us change our eye colors?
So the short answer is no. You know, the safest way for you to temporarily change your eye color, as you mentioned, is going to be a prescription and fitted color contact lens for you. You know, there have been not FDA approved methods for surgically or laser changing eye color, but they're dangerous. They can cause permanent eye damage and inflammation and loss of vision. So I think the safest way, if you want to, you know, get a temporary change in your color, are the contact lenses.
Definitely stick to contact lenses. Thank you so much for that, Dr. Salter. And was there anything else that you'd like to let our audience know about before we leave today?
I would say takeaway from the eye color change talk is if you notice a change in eye color, you should probably see your eye doctor because there might be something going on. And we're getting into the warmer months, so I'll just remind everybody to wear sunglasses for UV protection.
Well, again, thank you so much for being on here, Dr. Salter. Everyone, that was Dr. Amanda Salter. Dr. Salter, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.